Yay. So I met Laura Lengnick, our next speaker, a couple years ago when she speaks annually at the Climate Adaptation Conference that the Wonderful Abundance Foundation does here in Chatham County. And as a local food advocate, of course, I want to have her here again today. And she spoke at our Climate Convergence conference a couple years ago, too. But Laura is a researcher, author, policymaker, activist, educator, and farmer whose work explores the community-enhancing potential of sustainable agriculture and food systems. Laura contributed to the third National Climate Assessment as the lead author of the USDA report, Climate Change in Agriculture in the United States, Effects and Adaptation. After leading the academic program in sustainable agriculture at Warren Wilson for more than a decade, she is now an affiliated researcher with the Local Food Research Center and a climate resilience planning consultant with Fernley Solutions, both located in Asheville. She's the author of Resilient Agriculture, Cultivating Food Systems for a Changing Climate, and she's brought some books over there on that table. Please help me welcome Laura, all the way from Asheville.
Thanks, Karen. And so happy to be back. I think I was here 3 years ago or something like that. I'm trying to remember, what was that, 2014? So maybe I had finished my work on the book, but it wasn't out yet. Yeah, so fun to circle around again. So I was invited to speak about agriculture as a solution to climate change. More often than not, when I work with groups that are kind of focused on energy, which I feel like this group is sort of focused on energy, you might be a little bit wrong about that, but more often than not, what I hear in the side conversations and during the breaks is, you know, how bad agriculture is. And certainly that just reflects the general discussion about agriculture, how bad it is for the environment, for people, for climate change. And so what I'm trying to do with my work around resilient agriculture and climate change is to bring a different kind of message. I think there is a different message. It has a lot of integrity. And I don't want us as a society to forego the benefits of using agriculture to help us solve this issue of climate change. So that's what I want to talk to you here about just a little bit. There we go. So just a little bit of context setting. When I think about agriculture and climate change and food and all these and social justice and all these related issues, what I immediately think about is kind of what is the big picture? And we are definitely, the big picture is we are killing this planet. And I know you all, or many of you, believe that as well. But I think that to look at the reality of that, that we are in an unprecedented time. We are in an unprecedented time in our species history. We're talking big time. We're talking deep time. We have never been at a point where our activities are threatening the very systems that we depend on, natural systems that we depend on to survive. We're in an unprecedented time also in that this cultural evolution, this invention that our species created called agriculture, right, which absolutely defines us among all the species on the planet, was created and evolved in a time, a very unusual time in our planet's history. The last 10,000 years, we have been in a very unusual period of climate stability. So this thing that defines us as a species, we are all farmers, we are a farming species, actually developed in a time that was very unusual in our species history overall, the 250,000 years we've been on this planet. And we are at a point at the beginning of the 21st century in which all of that is changing. This changes everything. It's not just fossil fuel and climate change that changes everything. It's the way that we live. We will have to change everything. And we've already heard that. We've heard that a number of times today. That we are talking here about a cultural transformation. That's the way that I think about it. And so one way we could look at this is terrible. How are we going to do this? Save what we've got. We could also look at it as the greatest challenge that we faced as a species and what can we do to make a better world? What can we do to make a better world? And as we resolve this challenge. So I'm here to talk about food and agriculture. It says agriculture, but I'm with Wendell Berry when and I say that eating is an agricultural act. We all just had a wonderful lunch, and that directed us connected us very physically with the people that planted the seeds and tended those crops and picked those crops and brought them to the kitchen and made them. That's the whole, and prepared them for us to enjoy. So we are all connected in some way to agriculture. One of the farmers that I work with in resilient agriculture, I thought he said it best with regard to climate change. He said, this is Will Harris, he's a livestock farmer in South Georgia. He said, 1% of us are farmers, 100% of us are eaters. We are all affected by climate change. So just a tiny little bit of data, just to set the stage. And I know probably most of you know this, but food globally is responsible for about 25% of global emissions. So this is the part of the story in which agriculture is the bad actor, right? But it's not just farming, that's the whole food system. That's the whole food system. So when I first became aware of the impacts of agriculture on climate change, it's about really a decade ago, I started thinking, because I'm a scientist, so how do we fix this? How do we unpack that and start really thinking about what we can do? At first, it was just, how can I reduce the impacts? So that's the global data. Here is some data. This is different. Last slide was emissions. This slide is actual energy use, so energy input. And what this is energy input or consumed by the food system in the U.S., and then the food energy output. And I know that there's fairly well, general knowledge, it's fairly well known that we have a really energy inefficient food system, putting a lot of energy in to get food system out. I'm afraid you probably can't read all the different colors, the labels on the different colors in that big bar. But I'd like to show this slide to say that, yes, agriculture, let's see if I can use this thing, yeah. This is agricultural production. Yes, that is part of the problem. Absolutely. But this part of the bar is household storage and preparation. Which one's bigger? The household. Yeah. So this is another way to think about, you know, eating is an agricultural act, and we all have a role. We all have a role to play in how we reduce the impact of agriculture on climate change and other harms, social and environmental harms. What year is that? This data was put together about 2000. It's in the world of this kind of data, it's pretty recent. Yeah. Let's see, this is not working. There we go. So as I was looking around for good ideas, I was working on a national report, the USDA report that was mentioned in my introduction, and I was looking around for good ideas for how we approach this issue. I recognized it was an unprecedented challenge. I recognized that the kinds of the conditions that we're facing in this challenge we've never faced before. And I wanted to look around to see, is there any sort of particular framework or problem-solving approach that might be particularly useful. At the same time, I first became aware of the transition movement, the Transition Town movement. And one of the basic foundational ideas of that movement is this idea of resilience. I started looking into resilience as a possible way to structure solutions and was really amazed at what I found. Resilience is kind of the word, or it was. It's actually becoming a little passé already. But, you know, 4 years ago, it was like selling everything, right? Dog food and deodorant and all kinds of things. And as I got into looking at resilience, I realized it is a much deeper and much more powerful idea. It's actually a 50-year-old science. It's based in ecology. It's also got bases, it's developed over the last 50 years or so in four separate different disciplines: engineering, ecology, risk and hazards management, and psychology. And if there's one thing I know after 30 years of trying to work on solutions and trying to work on whole systems and how we really think holistically about how we structure our communities, one of the things I know is that when an idea pops up, starts to well up in many different contexts, from many different perspectives, that's an idea that I think is worth taking a good look at. So I took a good look at resilience. I don't have a lot of time today to go into what I discovered, but what I want you to be sure you remember, if you don't remember anything else from this presentation today, is that resilience is a whole lot more than bouncing back. In fact, I think that general discussion about the general understanding and the way we use that word of bouncing back is actually the least valuable thing about resilience. Because if you think about bouncing back, that means you sustained some kind of damage, right? But there's a whole range of other possibilities with resilience and managing for resilience. And the first one is response capacity, that you can create systems, communities, food systems, a farm, a family system. You can create systems that have the capacity to respond to disturbance in ways that avoid damage. So you can respond to avoid damage. You never have to bounce back because you never sustain the damage. The bounce back, the idea there more deeply in resilience theory is that you can recover quickly and at low cost, right? That's the bouncing back part. But the third part of resilience, I think, maybe has the most resonance and most applicability to what we've heard today. It's this idea that resilient systems can change, can be transformed, when the people in those systems recognize that the current system is not working for us. And I think probably everybody would agree in this room that the current system is not working for us. Yeah, so that's a really powerful idea in resilience theory that I think gets missed. So just to sum this up, what I'd like to say is we can think about bouncing forward. We can think about bouncing forward, not just about bouncing back. We are going to sustain damage. Our communities are going to sustain damage. Economy, all the different sectors in the coming years. We cannot avoid that from climate change. We cannot avoid that. But what we can do is decide that we are going to bounce forward to a newer and better way of living, of interacting with each other, of interacting with the planet. That is the real mess, the important message in resilience, I think. I just want to talk about one key quality of resilience. There are many. But one really important quality of resilience is that a resilient system, a community or a farm, has a balanced portfolio of high quality assets to work with. So what does that mean? That's a lot of kind of economic talk, I guess. But what does that really mean? Well, you have been hearing about that all day today. You have been hearing about the need to build social resources, to address social injustices. That's that social part, that social asset. You've been hearing about human capacity and the need for us to really work, reach out to other groups, reach out to other kinds of people, and build human capacity, both for resistance, also for change, for smart struggle. We've heard a lot about the natural world today. And a resilient system needs healthy ecosystems. Resilient human systems need healthy ecosystems. We need money. Money's part and parcel of how we do things. We've heard about that. We've heard about how new kinds of energy technologies can save us all sorts of money. So money is certainly part of the equation. And then the built assets, you can think of that as technology or technology and other kinds of infrastructure. Well, it turns out that what studies of resilience show that resilient communities, resilient businesses, they have a wealthy, balanced portfolio of assets to draw from. That gives them the capacity to innovate, to change, to recover from disaster when they do happen, and also to build to something new. Another thing that I, in the thinking about how we take resilience concepts and move it into kind of management ideas, this is what occurs to me. Oh, you know, I got one more thing to say about that. So as I develop these ideas and start applying them to agriculture and the food system, this is one thing that occurred to me, and I've heard it also over and over again, is that industrialism has systematically degraded natural, human, social, and financial resources, right? Extracted all those resources that industrialism has been so successful because it's been subsidized, not only by financial resources, but you can think, if you think more generally of subsidy, we have subsidized industrialism with environmental degradation, with community degradation, with human degradation, and with financial degradation. So the message of resilience is that we need to renew, we need to begin investing in, we need to restore this full portfolio of community assets in order for us to be successful. And I think it's true that if we focus only on one, let's say we put a ton of money into technology and create this wonderful 100% renewable energy web around the world, I don't think that's going to solve all our problems because it's just one part. So one of the things I learned thinking about resilience and agriculture and food is that the best kinds of solutions, and we just heard it from the last speaker, the best kinds of solutions are win-win, win-win-win. We're looking across all of those assets and we're looking for solutions. Yes, we're focused on the asset that we're particularly interested in, but we're taking the time to step back and see how it affects all the others. And if we're not finding wins in all those other asset classes, it is not a resilient solution. I don't think it's going to get us where we need to be. So thinking about this more practically, I think that resilience suggests that we're really going to have to shift management objectives from assumption of stability. We are in a whole new world of uncertainty that's unprecedented. We've never had to deal with this as a species. We're going to move from, we have to move from an assumption of stability to an assumption of high variability and extremes, and that's going to change solutions if we can't assume stable conditions. We need to move from national expert-driven best practices to local learn-as-you-go solutions. We need to build capacity at the local level to come up with solutions. We need to quit importing resources and start designing our systems so that we can live well on place-based renewable resources. We need to move from an extractive to a regenerative economy. I know I'm seeing heads shaking here. It's like I'm hitting little pockets with every one of these, right? We need to move from efficient, this is a little harder, to redundant systems. We're going to actually need to build more redundancy into our systems because there's more uncertainty. And we need to stop producing products and start producing community benefits. So that speaks to this idea of investing across this whole range of assets. So all of these ideas, all of these insights for me came from studying resilience at a deeper level than it means bouncing back. Okay.
Could you just quickly clarify what you mean by redundant systems of people?
Sure. Sure. So, you know, kind of the pinnacle of neoclassical economic development, technology was the just-in-time delivery system. Global flow of energy materials delivered just in time when you needed it. Does that make sense to everybody? There is no redundancy in that system. If you break the supply chain there, the whole factory stops. So there's no redundancy there, but it is the most efficient system that you can create, as long as you can assume stable conditions. Okay, so an example of a redundant system, let's take it into something I know, farming. You want more than one way to deliver water, right, to your crop. So that would be, but that's that
that invests some resources in something other than direct production. It invests resources in backup capacity. So it's not as efficient as having only one source. I'm going to try to take one more question, then we'll move on. Yeah, so what I mean by that is we want, for example, if you purchase something locally from a locally owned business, the money that you traded for that product stays in the local economy and stimulates more local economy. So it's regenerating or growing that local economy. If you buy something from Walmart, that most of that money leaves our local economy. So you can think of it as those kinds of businesses are extracting money from our local communities rather than money staying in that economy. I'm gonna move on. We're not even at the farming yet. But I'm glad there's so much interest in this because I think this is hugely important to what we're doing, now. Okay, a little bit about carbon farming. The mitigation potential of sustainable agriculture, aka carbon farming, which is sort of the darling right now of some parts of the ag and climate change movement. All I really want to say here is that there's huge potential. There are some examples of different practices that particularly increase the sequestration capacity of agriculture. Just one infographic to give you some sense of the potential, if you're not aware of it at all, is that if you compare sustainable/organic systems to conventional ag systems, you can achieve as much as a 50% reduction in CO2 emissions by switching from fertilizers to cover crop to other ways of providing nutrients for the crop. 50% reduction in energy use, 25% reduction in, 50% reduction in energy use, pastured beef versus fed beef. 25% overall reduction in energy use, organic versus conventional farming. And then you can have up to 50% more soil carbon sequestration with sustainable versus conventional. So there's a huge potential in agriculture. And this is why I say don't throw agriculture out with the bathwater. We really can be an important part of the solution. Okay, so as I was looking through that resilience discussion, thinking about it, I realized that a lot of these aspects of resilience and these aspects of carbon farming reminded me of sustainable agriculture. And I thought it would be pretty interesting to actually go out and do two things. One, ask American farmers about climate change. At the time I started this project, 2011, there was not one published article on what American farmers thought about climate change, about the kinds of changes they were seeing in weather. And I wanted to bring farmers' voices into this discussion. I think rural America in general has been less than served well by the climate change movement. So I wanted to bring some of those voices in. And very briefly, and you can learn more about it, I've brought some books here if you just want to take a look. I did a very large case study research project all around the country and asked farmers a lot about climate change. But I couldn't say climate change. When I asked them about climate change, they looked at me and they said, I'm not a scientist, I can't tell you about climate change. Or they said, climate change isn't happening. I stepped back, thought about it, and when I asked them, how's weather changing in the time you've been farming? Man, I could not get them to stop talking about it. And doesn't that make sense?
Yes.
These folks are on the front lines of climate change, right? Okay, so at this point, I want to show a little short 4-minute video. I've partnered with a group called the Climate Listening Project to do a bunch of short little videos featuring the farmers in the book. I did 27 case studies in the book, and we started with the Southeast. And I just want to bring their voices into this conversation. These are all award-winning sustainable farmers. They're all using ecological practices to produce their crops. And they have a lot to say, actually, about resilience, not that they would necessarily use that word. So can we see if we can get this going?
Resilience is a concept
requires us to see with new eyes, to ask different kinds of questions, to embrace uncertainty, and to find opportunity in change.
Not that long ago, you made it 10 to 15 years ago, I'm trying to fill out household work. And today, you know, you turn on the news, you hear. So, one of the discussions on the coming climate change discussions.
We've had last year over 100 grid temperatures for several days in a row. Not used to 100 degrees, maybe 1 or 2 days, but then back to then, like 4 or 5 days. So the temperature will be a lot hotter. The heat is not good, you know, and it'll take a toll on the cat.
Weather extremes are becoming more and more pronounced, more and more common. 2002 was the driest year in 100 years in Central North Carolina. 2003 was the wettest year in 100 years. 2007 was the driest year ever recorded here. 2010 was the hottest summer ever recorded. 2010, 11, and 12, July was the hottest in July ever recorded here.
Cooks, bottles, lemons, heaters, we're all impacted by climate.
Farmers and ranchers have something unique to teach us about climate resilience.
Traveling is so much easier than trying to live with what we lived with in the past when we sold our milk less than it cost us to make it. I'm not a grass trader. I'm a forager of crops. That's what makes me so happy is that they're having this beautiful, lush, quality forest thrown out of the year. And you can wait until the situation is already there. You got a drought, okay, so what can you plant? What can you not plant?
When I operated this farm as centralized, commoditized, industrialized farm, I built a fallout as a strip mine. It was an element of that kind of operation. But now that we operate it as a living, regenerative organism, the resilience of it comes from that.
We have always managed for bearing the weather because we get all kinds of weather here in the Southeast. And so we try to put our eggs in a lot of different baskets. We spread our risks to weather and everything else out by doing a wide variety of crops over a wide period of seasons. We are growing more crops under cover in greenhouses because that gives us a buffer against the weather. But in general, we have always managed for variable weather, and that serves us well as we get more variable weather.
We know enough to take the first steps along the path to our resilient future. Let's begin.
48 feet to the low tip pasteurizer to the bottom to the consumer, and it's all right here. And I have other people that are doing this now. They're grazing. I have farmers that are doing barley and the whole work, just everything that I
am. I don't have any doubt that people will continue to adapt and grow and learn in the face of whatever radical changes come along. But I don't think it's going to be easy.
I mean, the decision will lie not in the hands of those farmers. The decision will lie in the hands of the consumer that makes demands on how they want their food grown.
As I've said to many people who have limited knowledge of what it is that we do here, no matter what the weather's doing, it's usually benefiting something and it's detrimental to something else. But with a wide variety of things that we grow, it's a wide range of the season. It's our crop insurance, and it's what makes us successful.
The future here is very exciting to me. You know, when I first started making the changes from commoditized industrialized centralized agriculture to this organism that we call white pastures, I thought it was a destination. I now see it as a journey.
You can go ahead and cut that off and we'll move on. See, I got involved with this project because I understand too, we've heard this also, the power of story. The power of story, the power to see that, rather than data, to see and hear from people that have already achieved the transformation that I'm talking about in the agriculture and the food system. So you just heard from three farmers, Will Harris in Georgia, Tom Campbell in South Carolina, and Ken Dawson in North Carolina. So what did I learn overall? taking all the interviews and from farmers all over the country, growing all sustainable farmers, growing all kinds of different foods all over the country, here were some themes that emerged from the work that I did. First of all, soil health is incredibly important to resilience. Biodiversity is incredibly important to resilience as well. And both of those things create a very healthy farm environment, an ecosystem to produce food in. They also need a good living. They need to earn a good value for the work that they're doing, so that they're diverse not only in their farming operations, but in their marketing operations. Because of you heard about this earlier, it was the first speaker this morning, you know, we are getting about the same or maybe a little more rainfall as a result of climate change, but it is coming in a few huge bursts of rain and then long drought, punctuated by long periods of drought. So farmers all over the country are thinking about how to manage water. And then physical protection, not so much, so that's like growing in hoop houses or greenhouses, adding row covers, not just for temperature, which is typical, or insects, which has typically been what physical protection has been for, but also to protect from too much rain. These huge rainstorms are really affecting agriculture, the ability to manage crops in the field. But agriculture is more than just agriculture. It's more than just what's going on the farm. We are, we all participate in agriculture through the foods that we eat. And so these ideas of resilience can be expanded to the food system as a whole. And we can think about how do we create a commensal community, a community in which my eating does not require you to suffer or degrade your community. And these are kind of the latest ideas that are being explored in food systems, research and scholarship. Another one is the idea of proximity. We treat each other better, we know this about our species, if we can engage with each other, if we're close to each other and can see how our actions harm another or benefit another. So proximity is important. And then nature as measure, this idea that we can learn, we can model human systems on ecological systems. This idea that we can do that is certainly was shown in my research and in the food system. There we go. So just where do we go in the food system? I just want to give you a few quick pictures of the kind of thinking that's going on. How do we take it from the farm and go to the food system? And this first picture, it's a little difficult to see, but this is created by the planner. So there's lots of different kinds of groups and organizations and parts of society that are beginning to really turn their focus toward food and what are going to do about it. And one of them is the planner. So this is actually a map put out by the American Planning Association. This is America in 2050. So this is a vision. Can you see, let's see. Can y'all kind of see those groups? It's pretty washed out in this. Well, it turns out that by 2050, most of America's population, almost 80% of us, are going to live in one of 11 mega metropolitan regions.
No way.
That's already happening. And where are we? Let's see, right in here. You're right in here. I think Raleigh might be right around there, right? Okay. So this is how are we going to feed these people? And isn't this going to increase the divide that already exists between rural America and metropolitan, urban America, suburban America, right? Well, this is a challenge, but the planners, I'm happy to tell you, see it as an amazing opportunity. Why? Because the infrastructure in all these metropolitan areas are way overdue for a rehaul. They are right now planning all the systems we need to live well in metropolitan areas. And for the first time, they are including food in that planning.
Yeah.
So that's a huge opportunity. It's a huge opportunity for us. The nutritionists, the folks thinking about public health, have also been thinking, what do we do about the food system? And they came up with, this was worked on in Columbia, they came up with what they called an integrated network of metropolitan food sheds. They're thinking about metropolitan areas as a focus of food consumption, and they're thinking about how we're going to feed those areas from areas proximate to those metropolitan areas. So this idea of proximity is also bubbling up in the nutrition and public health community. Another idea that is absolutely going to inform all of this work on how we restructure the food system is this idea of the city region. And it's an idea that's coming up in international sustainable development. And the idea is that we no longer view the cities as receiving services from the countryside, an extractive relationship, and start looking at how we can make it a mutually beneficial relationship. So a lot of great ideas happening there. There's a great project, if you haven't heard of it, it's called 100 Resilient Cities, and a big portion of that effort is being focused on food and how we're going to feed cities. That's a Rockefeller-funded project. So you can see these ideas are bubbling up all over. And what we're seeing in most of the discussion is feed ourselves regionally with sustainable and organic practices. So I'm always asked, what do I do? So I'm going to set that off. So I just heard about this, a friend of mine, this was the day after the election. She said, action is the antidote to despair. I tried to find out who said that, but it's confusing online about who said that. But here's what I would tell you to do, and this is based on lots of research and applied work in the U.S. food system. The first thing is, as much as you can, eat local, sustainable, organic, and remember that eat local could mean grow your own, right? Eat less meat, absolutely we need to do that. And we need to make that any meat that we do eat pasture-based meat. Use less refrigeration, so it turns out that 17% of that whole energy bar of food energy input is refrigeration. So let's use less of that if we can. And then obviously reduce waste. I'm thinking this crowd is already hip to the food waste issue. If you're not, something like 20 to 30% of all the edible food produced in this country, and more than that globally, but about 30% is wasted, is thrown away, uneaten. It goes to landfills and creates methane. Okay? So last thing. So we've got sort of your what you can do at home, what you can do in your own life, but it's really important to understand that resilience is not the resilience of the kind that I'm talking about is not a personal or family characteristic. It's a community. It's a community characteristic. We have to gather together to think about how we're going to change the way we organize our communities. And so these are just a few of the groups that are thinking specifically about food and agriculture issues and how we as a community decide to approach these challenges.
And the slides.
Probably could make that happen. So I just want to end. We'll figure out how to make that happen. I just want to end with this quote from Ken Dawson. He's a vegetable farmer, just a little bit west of here. The way I look at it, we are all in this together, and I think that speaks really well to the resilience message as well. So I know we're all running late, but maybe I have time for one or two questions. One. Okay. A question. Let's have questions.
I'm sure you encounter skeptics who say that there's no proof that the current climate anomalies are not the result of the natural causes. How do you answer that?
I have learned in my work in the ag community to just sidestep that. Because the farmers themselves know that weather is changing. Whether or not it's happening because of human activities, I think right now it's less important for me to win that argument, which as I understand it, I'm not going to win anyway because facts actually don't change anybody's beliefs,
exactly.
Right?
Yeah.
So I say, great, let's let's meet, at least for me in the ag community, let's meet people where they are. And where they are is they need help figuring out how to manage more variable weather and remain productive. There are tons of questions. I think we're gonna have to move on.
One more,
okay. Do you have a question?
Sorry.
That's okay.
The question is, what do you do about that?
What do we do about GMOs and KFOs?
About factory farming, when we have
So I'll say right here, we have to stop factory farming animals. If we're thinking about it in a context of climate change, in the context of environment, if you just go down this list of assets, factory farming is bad for every single one. It harms every single one of those, every single. So we just need to stop that. When I entered this project, I was predictably anti-GMO, you could call me that maybe, as a sustainable researcher for 30 years. I see all sorts of social and potentially environmental damages caused by GMOs. As a result of learning about resilience, I'm reluctant to throw any tool out of the box. I'm just reluctant to do that now. And so there may be good reasons sometimes to use that technology. That's where I am now. Thank you.
Yay.